Hello, everybody. Thank you for coming to my talk. And Paul and Peter, our new center, research center directors, I've got my beautiful, stylish commemorative mug celebrating the opening of our center with me. So the title of my talk is Captive Geographies, Places, Identities, and Activity Space Segregation in Belfast. Now, if I was giving this talk probably 100 years ago, it would have looked quite different, I suspect. At that time, many social scientists saw segregation as a natural reflection of group differences or group hierarchies, and they also saw segregation as a way of managing problems of conflict in divided societies. If we keep people apart, if we stop them from having contact, we're likely to have more social harmony. That was the kind of logic. More recently, social scientists have moved from that view, and I think for two reasons. Segregation has come to be seen as a problem, firstly, because it has repeatedly been shown in study after study to be associated with the production of inequality, of an economic, health, and educational inequality, for example. Segregation is also no longer seen as a solution to problems of intergroup conflict. In fact, exactly the opposite is true. Segregation is now believed actually increases distrust, prejudice, a tendency to treat others as a threat, and so forth. So in studying segregation, the predominant sort of paradigm has been to study it at the level of the city at a big macro scale. And most research on segregation has given priority to residential segregation, that is segregation established through where people live. If you look at this first slide, for example, this represents residential segregation in the city of Chicago. And you can see here a pattern characteristic of many American cities, which is you've got a kind of ethnic minority and racial groups concentrated in the inner city basin. And as you go out to the more affluent suburbs, it becomes increasingly white in terms of residential composition. Now, you might say, why is that a problem? Why is that seen as a problem? Groups or communities can choose to live where they want in a city. And of course, to a large extent, that's true. But it's also true that segregation is associated with a range of social problems. And one of those is illustrated by the figure in the panel to the right of this slide. This panel models the relationship, this panel models the relationship between, on the one hand, the degree of white-black segregation, the x-axis, and on the other hand, the income gap between black and white residents in cities. And as you can see, there's a positive linear relationship between the two. As a city becomes more segregated, so too the likelihood that the income gap between black and white residents will increase. So an awful lot of work has been looking at this kind of approach to segregation and trying to understand how it links to things like income inequality. Now, I like this tradition of work, and what I'm going to talk about today is by no means a critique. I think our work is complementary to this work, actually. And over the past probably 15 or 20 years or so, we've been developing a different sort of approach, a different framework for studying segregation. That is, studying it not at the macro level of the city and residential areas, or through studying big institutions like education, but by looking at how segregation manifests at a more microecological level in the spaces of everyday life and everyday activity spaces. As we go about our business outside the home, go to parks, visit shops, meet friends and so forth, how does segregation emerge in these kinds of spaces? Let me give you a concrete example. This example shows, in fact, how authorities attempting to legalize segregation have always had a great interest in activity spaces. Under Jim Crow legislation in the American South, in the early years of the last century, for example, there were a whole raft of laws which determined what water fountain you could use, where you could sit, what restaurant you could use, and also even determined, as we can see in this example, people's use of space within public transport. The white precedent law, that's what it was called, mandated that no black person could sit alongside or in front of any white person on public transport, and it resulted in a pattern demonstrated in this photograph. And the quotation by Dreger here is attempting to capture not only the kind of material nature of this, but also what it symbolized. Of course, a kind of way of organizing space such as this prevents contact between communities. After all, black passengers are essentially looking at the back of white passengers' heads for most of the time. But also it symbolizes something. It literally embodies a certain idea about race and race relations. In dividing into front and back areas, black and white passengers, you heighten the salience of racial categories. And you also, of course, reproduce a certain set of status assumptions, because after all, who's in the back of the bus and who's in the front? What was true of relations in under Jim Crow is, of course, also true of relations elsewhere. In South Africa, where I grew up, a petty apartheid legislation attempted constantly to interfere with relations in everyday spaces, determining which beaches you could go, which park benches you could sit on, which queue you joined to, you know, in the post office and so forth. So more recently, what we've been doing is we've been trying to develop methods, I think, essentially for studying and understanding activity space segregation. And I've been working with colleagues on what we call the Belfast Mobility Project, a project located in Belfast and focused on relations in that city. This is our team. As you can see, it's a diverse team: anthropologists, geographers, GIS experts, psychologists. And I think I'll just pause and give a little plug for our research center and say, look, one of the things I'm really excited about our new research center is that we are both interdisciplinary in orientation, but also I think methodologically eclectic and adventurous, and I like that. And so the Belfast Mobility Project, as I've said, is attempting to develop new methods for understanding activity space segregation, a new suite of methods. You can't, when you study activity space segregation, rely on the same methods that are used when studying residential segregation, which have the advantage of being able to draw on mass census data like we've just gathered in the UK. You have to find some way of capturing it live and over time, activity space segregation, that is. And we've used three methods. First of all, we've developed a GPS tracking app that goes on residents' mobile phones that allows us to track their movements and where they spend time outside the home in the city. Secondly, we've used a more standard psychological technique, a questionnaire, which measures self-reported activity space segregation and then other psychological and social constructs that might be related to it. And finally, I think probably most interesting source of data has been data basically using walking interviews. These are walk-along interviews that in which residents take us through the streets of their neighborhoods, take us through their normal pathways, take us through their normal activity spaces and talk about those things. And particularly we were interested in their accounts of how they manage the problems of living in a divided part of the city, how that shapes where they go, what activity spaces they use, what routes they take, and so forth. So that's the methodology. So the aims of my talk are threefold. First of all, I'll begin by giving a bit of context, including showing you a few bits and pieces of data using the tracking app that we developed. Second, I'm going to discuss briefly the concept of captive geographies, which captures for me one aspect of people's lived experiences of moving around the spaces of North Belfast. And finally, I'm going to talk about how place identity relations are very important in understanding activity space segregation. In order to understand it, you need to know where and why people feel they belong, and as important, where and why they feel they don't belong, where they feel out of place, or where they disidentify with particular spaces or pathways. So that's where we're going. These are our study sites, and we chose them deliberately. As you can see, in this part of North Belfast, what you've got is an interesting checkerboard pattern. We've got Protestant and Catholic communities living in very close proximity to one another, and yet divided by various symbolic and indeed material barriers. So for example, the historically Protestant and demographically Protestant area of Tiger Bay is adjacent to, abutting the historically and demographically Catholic area of the New Lodge. And the reason we chose this area of the city is, again, because of this proximity, we felt that issues such as choosing the right pathways, sharing activity spaces and so forth becomes a pressing everyday concern for our residents. How they navigate this, these spaces, which are sectarian in organization, is therefore an interesting problem. Another aspect of the context of North Belfast is captured in the second part, the right-hand side of this slide, which models the distribution of conflict-related deaths in Belfast. During the Troubles, there were something like 3,700 people killed and many, many, many more injured. 40,000 plus people were maimed or shot or lost limbs or kneecapped or generally terrorized. And a lot of those people lived in North Belfast. North Belfast was an area which the violence was condensed and took its most extreme forms. And so in understanding the data I present later on walking interviews, you have to understand, I think, that historical context of what happened, you know, 20 years ago. In addition, I want to make one further point, which is to do with the relationship between this violence and space and mobility. I mean, people often ask me, John, you know, how do you tell Catholics apart from Protestants? And I always say, you know, my Belfast colleagues will know what I mean here. We have our ways in Northern Ireland of doing so. But one of the ways, which is often, I think, neglected that this has been accomplished, is through people's use of space. Because during the Troubles, people were targeted for violence based on where they were, or as important, where they were moving towards. And so their choice of pathways or the location in space was a means through which people were classified and targeted as Catholic or Protestant. I think that, again, is an important part of the context of understanding people's attitudes towards activity spaces. So in our study, we had questionnaire data, as I said, and when we asked people questions like, would you be willing to move through spaces associated with the other community? Would you use facilities or activities, you know, pubs, restaurants, takeaways located in the other community's areas? 65, a very heartening and optimistic 65% of them said yes. However, when we looked at the actual tracking data, and that's what we're looking at now, which measured using GPS tracking how long people spent in different sorts of places, a very different pattern emerges, as you can see. Vanishingly little time was spent by members of either Protestant or Catholic communities in the other group's activity spaces, or going to destinations located there, or using pathways that took people's journeys through the other group spaces. Most of the time people spent moving around either the city centre or in their own tertiary street networks, their own community networks. There was, as you can see, over a degree of sharing of social space, but I think it's revealing to see what kinds of spaces were shared, and that's captured in the right-hand side of this slide. This illustrates how, in fact, the spaces that are shared are of a very particular type. They are either public spaces of a general kind, like the city centre, or they're what Agu once called non-spaces. They're spaces that are stripped off specific historical meanings or associations with sectarianism, stripped of any explicit identity relevant connection to being Protestant or being Catholic in this case. They're spaces in which, in fact, people don't really meet one another as members of different communities. They meet as consumers and as individuals. And I think that, again, is a revealing part of the context. So finally, in this section, I'll show you a rather pretty GIS image of our data, which represents the same data in a different form. And this shows, again, roughly what we've been speaking about. If you track people's movements and pathways and see how much time they spend moving around, what you get is this very distinctive pattern. People within their own community stick very much to their local tertiary street networks. Protestants and Catholics, but there are shared pathways and there are shared destinations. As this figure shows you, the shared pathways are these big arterial routes that run from North Belfast into the city centre. These are shared, though the within community tertiary street works are not shared. At the same time, there are shared destinations. People go to Lidl, they go to retail parks, they go to golf courses, they go to the city centre, and these spaces are shared and neutral, or they're shared, and I think for the reasons that we've already been beginning to discuss. So these are the patterns of activity-space segregation. They're not actually all that subtle, they're extreme. So suppose what we want to do now is understand two things. One, how these patterns are lived and experienced and understood by residents themselves. And two, why they're reproduced. Why do we get the reproduction of segregation through everyday movements and use of spaces outside the home? That's what we'll go on to look at next. So in order to begin to address these goals, I'm working on a concept called captive geographies. I came up with the concept just simply because it seemed to capture how people themselves talk about activity, space use, and pathways. They often talked about it in our interviews using metaphors of constraint or captivity. We feel hemmed in, walled in. They talked about, as we'll see, in terms of pathways that they wish they could take but couldn't because they were constrained, or facilities that they would use but didn't because they were associated with members of another group. I think the concept's easier to grasp if I give some concrete examples. So here is one example, participant. Well, I would always walk down the street. I would never walk down and along because also you've got down the front of the road, it's mainly Catholic as well because you've got the chapel, you've got St. Mary's, Star of the Sea. So people are all getting their kids from school and it's all a Catholic area, so I would avoid walking down the front of the road and down to the right because I'd rather walk down the hill till I'm at the bottom of Gray's Lane, which is Protestant. So you would avoid the Shore Road then, yeah. Yes, and this street right here is again Greymount Road. Greymount Road, so you would go down. I would go down Greymount Parade to get to where I was going. Even to get the bus, you have to go down this street to the very bottom. I note in that last section, the interviewee alludes to something which perhaps people living outside Northern Ireland don't know, that in Belfast, very often the bus stop you go to may not be the most convenient or closest because bus stops themselves have sectarian meanings and are associated with either being a Catholic or a Protestant bus stop, with all of the inconvenience actually that this causes. So this is one example of activity space segregation. And it's also an example of what we're talking about when we talk about captive geographies. People's decisions about pathways are constrained and shaped by the sectarian geography of the city. So here's a second example. And this one refers to accessing public resources. And it shows how actually activity space segregation is also a matter of social justice. It shapes whether people can actually benefit from the resources of the city. So I'll play you the extract.
Play area down here, and a lot of times I've taken my son down to Fusco's down here and he's walked past and said, "Mommy, can I go in there?"
Yeah.
And I can't explain why he can't go in there because there's a Catholic play area. And I said, "Son, you can't go in there because that's for other children to play in." And he went, "What do you mean?" And he doesn't understand Catholic and Protestant. So it's so hard to explain why he can't go in there. I mean, play areas are meant to be for all children, but obviously that's their play area, you know. So it's a bit hard to try and explain to a 5-year-old that he cannot go into a Catholic play area.
But he wants to go in.
He wants to go in. That's why I don't bring him down here anymore now.
So as a final example of what we mean by captive geographies, I'll give you an example where I'm calling landscapes of defense. As you know, in Northern Ireland, we have over 100 peace walls built to divide communities from one another. Sometimes they take the form of literally massive walls. Other times they're smaller structures like fences, and in this case, a kind of corrugated iron sort of passageway that's blocked off. And these peace walls are divide communities, but they're also inconvenient for those same communities because they mean they can't get from A to B, from one road into their communities by the most efficient means. And so that's one of the reasons why some of the peace walls have gates that can be opened and shut. And in this account, the interviewee explains how inconvenient it is when these gates are locked. They're often locked at night. And she explains how the positioning of this wall plus the closing of the gate means she's got a long, circuitous route to go to get back to her own community. So these are three examples of how living in a sectarian part of the city shapes the mobility choices and activity space uses of residents. So in attempting to understand why and how this process unfolds, I've been reading in an area of geography called time geography. And time geography is not designed to explain segregation. It's designed to provide a general suite of concepts that might be useful to understanding people's use of space over time. One of those concepts, for example, which is quite foundational, is the notion of a space-time path, the spatial trajectories that individuals routinely take over time within their everyday life. And those trajectories, you know, we would argue, reproduced over countless individuals and lots of pathways, literally in a living, everyday sense, reproduce activity space segregation. It's a dynamic, unfolding, reproducible system. And it's part of what Pred will then call the choreography of everyday life. Isn't that a beautiful concept? I wish I had written that. So you've got these concepts, and also the time geography is what is a constraint-based model, essentially. It explores how certain constraints shape time geography of everyday life. And three constraints that time geographers focus on are capability constraints, coupling constraints, and authority constraints. Capability constraints are simply constraints shaped arising from the limits of the human body or access to technology such as cars. So for example, if someone has a disability and can't have access to a mobility scooter or a wheelchair, or someone doesn't have access to a car and has to rely on public transport, this shapes the kind of time-space trajectories that they can take. Likewise, coupling constraints. If, for example, a mother, a Protestant mother, has to take her child to school or to a play group every day along a certain path, then, and if in that school or play group, basically other Protestant mothers congregate and with their own children, this represents a kind of coupling constraint. By being there and taking that pathway in a routine basis to do these activities, you cannot, by definition, be elsewhere. And so the constraint to be certain places or to interact with certain people at certain times shapes time geography. And finally, probably the most obviously related to segregation is the notion of authority constraints. We do not have free movement and free access to all spaces at all times. The authorities often regulate that access and regulate your movements there. So, for example, the example of a locked gate in a peace wall, when that gate is locked, that pathway is denied to you and you have to use another pathway. So clearly, time geography, it's a generic general framework which provides useful concepts for a constraint-based model, but it's not a framework that's designed to explain activity-space segregation. So what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to take the basic ideas of time geography, the concepts, and take them in a psychosocial direction. So for example, if you look at this interview quote, you can see on the right the track that the person took that we've traced in GIS. And at a certain point in this track, the person stopped and said he wasn't prepared to walk up any further, up a place called the Deer Park Road, because of fear. And as you can see in this account, he relates an anecdote about how at a certain time, I think it was about 20 years ago, a young Catholic man was beaten to death at a point in Deer Park Road. And clearly he remembers the exact point. He points to it. And this kind of very vivid, dramatic example, which again links fear, mobility, and violence, the theme I mentioned earlier on in the talk. I'm choosing it because it shows you something important. What the fear is of is not only a fear of being beaten up, it's not only fear of others. Somehow that fear has seeped into the place itself. It's become part of how this person, as he uses space, remembers that place. It's become part of what Pete Serlo rather nicely calls the landscape of fear in North Belfast. And so I'm going to develop, take this idea in a slightly different direction in the final section of the talk. So basically, I'm working on a paper now that takes all these ideas but focuses on the role of place identification in the reproduction of activity space segregation. By place identification, I mean our sense of where we belong, our sense of attachment, where we as a community, or we as individuals belong. But also, I think as important and often neglected in environmental psychology, it encompasses notions of where we don't belong, places we are alienated from or estranged from or feel out of place. And I think these two moments, the belonging and the not belonging, interrelate to shape activity space segregation. So here's one of our interview tracks. I'm just putting it up to show you to kind of prepare the way here. So typically what would happen in walking interviews is people would start in their home spaces and they describe their feelings there and very often why they feel in place. They would then take us around and often point to spaces that are shared. In this case, in extract B, the interviewee points to a complex, which is a medical complex that he speculates is used by both communities. And then finally, they would take us to the verges, the margins of their own community, and show us the boundary lines between us and them. And that's where the participant in point C in this trajectory is literally standing at a peace wall, a dividing wall between the Ardoyne, which is Catholic, where he lives, and Glen Bryn, which is a Protestant area. So in the course of this journey, almost different forms of place identity were evoked and discussed by participants. Let me give you an example. So in the more in-group spaces, activity spaces, you had many accounts like this, where you had accounts where people talked about belonging, talked about familiarity, talked about being comfortable and safe. And they articulated here a sense of what I would call social insideness, familiarity with who they were, with the environment. Sometimes they took us to spots here that were more than that, that were had very clear, dramatic, and often dramatic collective meanings as part of Protestant or Catholic communities. This person, for example, took us to this community mural. And as you can see, he explains when he sees this mural, in fact, and another mural close by, he feels when he comes towards it, he's coming home. This is an example of how the sensuous geography of spaces, visual geography of spaces in Belfast, communicate notions of belonging. And of course, it goes without saying, it also communicates the opposite. For Protestants who live in Tagore Bay, this sort of wall mural invites them home, but for other members of other communities, it does precisely the opposite. As part of this, and I think something I find quite poignant listening to the walking interviews, there were a lot of people took us to spaces of remembrance. And in Belfast, these spaces of remembrance of people who've been murdered, for example, or killed in the Troubles, are actually built into everyday space. They're not put out in cemeteries. So here is one. This is a remembrance space on a street that kind of remembered UDA activists who basically were killed during the Troubles. And this woman, in fact, showed us as part of her walking interview the space or the place where her brother was murdered, which was literally en route. And then she took us here, and you can see at the end, she said, there's my brother's name. So these are spaces, they're not just spaces of familiarity, they're spaces of identity in a deeper, richer sense, connect people to place. But of course, the opposite, therefore, is also true. Just as you have spaces of identification, familiarity, and at easiness, you also, as you move through this environment, encounter spaces that are the opposite, where you disidentify, you feel uncomfortable. Now, in some cases, walking interviewees, when they would encounter such spaces, would not be able to fully articulate why they feel uncomfortable. They often said, look, I don't think I'll be attacked here or anything like that. It's just that space, in this case, the person is literally pointing to a space across the road, very, very close by, but just across the road would be sufficient to produce a sense of discomfort. This is not our space. And he describes how he wouldn't stand there at night or have a smoke or anything like that. Now, sometimes, of course, this vague sense of discomfort is heightened again by the visual and sensuous landscape of the streets and activity spaces of North Belfast, which are often marked by things like flags or curbstone painting or wall murals or certain sorts of Irish language signs and so forth. So in this extract, the person describes a hypothetical situation in which if he saw certain insignia, how he would feel. And he suggests if he saw the Union Jack and the red, white and blue curb painting and broke down his car, he'd feel completely safe and comfortable. But if he saw the green, white and gold of the tricolour in another ear, he would feel exactly the opposite. So these are just some of the ideas that we're working on in terms of building a model of how place identity dynamics shape activity space segregation and mobility practices. So I conclude then on a few final reflections on social change. I'm at the end of my time, it's 30 minutes, but I promised Paul and Peter that I would say something about social change and social justice, because I think it's a very important and central theme of our centre and our research centre. So in terms of social change, one of the things I think the sorts of work that we're doing illustrate is that if you want to change relations between communities in North Belfast or elsewhere in Northern Ireland, it's not enough to have interventions to transform their perceptions and feelings about one another as human beings. You also have to, in a real way, transform their relationships to the places and spaces of everyday life, the places they live in. Because as long as those spaces are associated with sectarian meanings and patterns of identification, then segregation will persist. So how do you accomplish that? Well, that's what we're going to be looking at as we develop our work. But let me give you an end on a few examples of how it's already being done. Because, of course, the Belfast City Council, who we've worked with, the Department of Justice, who we've also worked with, and others are already working on these things. They have an intuitive grasp about this problem. So here are three things that are going on in Northern Ireland already. First, we have a program that plans to demolish peace walls. Now, peace walls not only are impediments to people's mobility, not only do they stop the free use of city spaces and divide communities, but they're also deeply symbolic. They recreate others as a threat actively. And so their demolition, which will be a long and difficult process, is part of this process of changing people's relations to place. Second of all, there's active attempts to transform the visual landscape of everyday spaces, which, in as you've seen already, it very strongly marks sectarian divisions in North Belfast. There's a project which one of our team members, Dominic Bryan, is working on at the minute, that's looking at flags. And maybe if Dominic is here, I don't know whether he's been able to come, he can talk about that. And finally, there's a project to transform wall murals. Murals are part of the kind of living human geography of everyday spaces in Belfast and elsewhere. A lot of them have looked historically like this, threatening, sectarian. And there's a program to replace these kinds of sectarian paramilitary wall murals with murals like this, which are explicitly designed to remove threat and to make people feel included, make people feel that this space is open to all. And I'll just say that guy there in the picture, the boxer, is a guy called Rinty Monaghan. I think he's a very clever choice of a kind of visual image for this wall mural, because he's been chosen because Rinty Monaghan was our first world champion boxer in Northern Ireland. And he was someone who was beloved by members of both communities, someone who's embraced by members of both communities. And of course, he was also someone who was born and raised in Belfast, in fact, in North Belfast, which is a nice symbolic way to end the talk. Thank you very much, colleagues, and I look forward to taking your questions.